And I think about 4 or 5 years ago, I came up with these potting medias that were sold in the market. And these days, there were a lot of competitors. A lot of people have come up with, you know, their own formulas or even similar formulas to mine. So I thought it was redundant for me to be in the market anymore. So I've pulled them off the shelves, I think 2 to 3 years ago. So I no longer have potting media on sale. Just so you know, I'm not selling you a product in this episode, but I'm really showing you how to create your own potting mix and hopefully you have some success growing your plants. Now, in the past, I have had released some videos on some different types of potting media that I've used, namely the garden soil, the forest floor, general potting media, and famous aeroid potting mix. Now, a lot of you have been following the channel for a very long time and you're familiar with those medias. But the reason why I've made a switch to this current media is a few reasons. Number one, I moved into a much smaller house. That means I don't have all this storage space for all these different types of potting media. Number two, I wanted to simplify my ingredient. I wanted to save some space, save some money, save some time. And I want a potting media that is like a one for all. Now for epiphytic plants like aeroids, I do supplement them with bark and charcoal above this current media. So this is sort of a general potting mix that really works for most types of plants. And for me, I've had really good results. On top of that, I've also learned to ferment my media. That means using eco-enzymes, and I've been starting to introduce some beneficial mycorrhizae fungi and trichoderma to sort of help the root better uptake the nutrients. It also helps create an ecosystem in the potting media that prevents disease and pests. So I'm gonna show you all that in this episode. Now, when you're creating your own mix, there are some factors that you have to consider. Such as number one, the availability of the raw materials or ingredients in your area. And one thing to consider when you're choosing ingredients for this potting mix is, for each of the ingredients, how fast do they absorb water and nutrients, and how readily they release this water and nutrients. I've created sort of a star system, like 1 out of 5, just based on my personal experience, and I'll share it throughout the video for each of the ingredients. And the next thing is, it really depends on the type of plants you're growing in your environment. How often are you willing to water that plant? For me, I actually hose down my plants indiscriminately every single day. There are certain plants that I kind of water less than others. There are certain areas in the house where I water slightly differently, but they really just do get watered every day. So for me, a fast draining potting media is important. And I also noticed in my garden, the fastest way that I kill a plant is by overwatering and root rot. So it really depends on your situation. Some of you may only want to water your plants once a week, in which case you might want something that don't dry up as fast. And the next important thing that I noticed is that after we've come out of lockdowns and COVID and all that, when back then we had a lot of time to come up with all these recipes, we have all these ingredients, but these days we're looking really more for simplicity, things that are easier and faster and manageable. And the next factor would be your storage. How much storage space do you have for these raw ingredients? And finally, of course, the cost. Some ingredients can cost a lot more than the others. It could be double, triple. So it really depends on what you have in your area as well as your budget. And this is what my garden center looks like. I could opt to buy potting media online, but then the shipping fee would cost too much. So I would drive down about 25 minutes to this exact store to buy most of my potting media. And I'm gonna impose on the screen right now some of the common ingredients that I used before and its absorption and its release rate. Feel free to screenshot this in case it's helpful to you. Now, keep in mind that this is not based on science or data, but it's based on my personal experience. So take it with a bit of a grain of salt. So I now use rice hull, burnt rice hull, perlite, and worm casting as the main component. So basically what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna scoop the media into this bin right here, and I'm gonna count exactly how many scoops there are. So this is how I kinda know the ratio. So here we've got around 20 scoops of rice hull, 20 scoops of burnt rice hull, and around 8 scoops of the perlite. Now with that, that gives about 48 scoops of this, and then the worm casting actually provides nutrients to the media. Now you don't want to add too much worm casting because too much organic material can also rot your plant. So I would say 10% is like a good ballpark for worm casting. And with that, we've got about 48 scoops of media in here. So that would be around 5 scoops of the worm casting. Now you're gonna see in a minute why I'm wearing my shades. When you mix this, the perlite is gonna push out dust all over the place. In fact, I might mix most of this on the floor away from my face because this is too close to my face. I'm gonna finish this on the floor. All right, so what we have now is this beautiful mix of media. And I love the color of this, but also I can feel in my hands here how fast this was absorbed the water, but also it would quickly release them. And also in this way, the water can be more even throughout the pot. Because of how porous this media is, when you water it, the water can trickle down really fast. What else if you use something heavy like a cocoa peat or like just peat moss, the top part may be dry or the bottom part may be super wet. It will not just be even throughout the pot, but this will create a lot more evenness around the pot, if it makes any sense. All right, now in the past, my journey would end here. This would just be the finished potting media. But now I've gone further and I found that this is quite helpful. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna add some eco-enzyme into this. So this is about 2 liters of water, just 1 teaspoon, which equates to around 5 milliliters of eco-enzyme. I'm gonna give this a good shake and I'm gonna spray it down evenly into this.
The eco-enzyme is a natural fermented liquid made from fruit and vegetable scraps, brown sugar, and water. This mixture is allowed to ferment for several months, resulting in a liquid with various cleaning, disinfectant, and fertilizer properties. It's a sustainable alternative to chemical-based cleaners and pesticides. Anyone with the time, determination, and space to make your own eco-enzyme can do so, but I purchased mine online since it's so inexpensive. Eco-enzymes offer several benefits for plants, including acting as a natural fertilizer, boosting plant growth, and serving as a biopesticide. This means repelling pests and preventing disease. They can also help improve soil health by breaking down organic matter and enriching the soil with nutrients, leading to more robust and happier plants. Once applied to your mix, let it ferment for 1 to 2 weeks before use. You may also use eco-enzyme as a foliar spray, diluting it with water and spraying down the entire plant. Keep in mind that the NPK ratio varies greatly on the raw materials used.
If you have ready-made potting mix, you might want to do this to your potting mix, and it's going to have a lot of benefits for the plants. I'm going to add to 1 liter of water around 5 grams of mycorrhizae, and I've conveniently placed them in this little food container. And then around 1.5 grams, which is super tiny amounts of Trichoderma. And because this is like not exactly soluble, we're gonna pour it slowly into this mix.
Mycorrhizae are a symbiotic fungi that form a mutually beneficial relationship with plant roots, offering several advantages to plants. These fungi enhance soil health, plant growth, nutrient uptake, and stress resistance, while the plant provides fungus with carbohydrates. Mycorrhizae helps plant become more resilient to various stresses. It can improve plant vigor, leading to larger plant growth. They can also increase plant tolerance to soil-borne diseases and diseases caused by nematodes. Trichoderma also stimulates plant growth and development by releasing plant hormones and breaking down organic matter. By enhancing nutrient and water uptake, these fungi can reduce the need for synthetic fertilizers. Increased plant resilience and disease resistance can also lead to a reduction in pesticide use. You may use these as soil drench to existing plants, but keep in mind that it is highly not recommended to use any chemical fertilizer or pesticide for 2 weeks.
Alright, so what you have now is this moist media, and it's ready to ferment. Now, the ideal time is around 2 weeks, but you can also use it in 1 week's time if it's super urgent for you, but the optimal time really is 2 weeks. And in fact, you could probably wait a little bit longer than that. Now, in the first week or so, you might wanna put a lid on loosely, not cover it, because it will release oxygen. So if you cover it entirely, this container might burst. And then in about 2 weeks' time, when it's ready to be used, you might wanna seal it completely to sort of keep the maximum potency of the potting media. Now, I've been using eco-enzyme for about 6 to 7 months now, and it's been wonderful. And I've been adding the mycorrhizae and trichoderma for the past 3 or 4 months, and I've noticed some really wonderful growth in my plants, which is why I was eager to share with you this new potting mix recipe. Of course, if you don't have this in your area, don't worry about it. Any potting mix will do. Your plants will grow healthy. In fact, sometimes when you have plants that are growing way too fast, that could also be a problem. We do want to keep our growth rate steady. We want to enjoy our plants for a long time. Of course, there's always better ways to improve it. So feel free to comment down below. Let me know if there's anything that I could have done better, anything that I could have done differently, and I welcome any suggestions and constructive criticism. This media works for literally most types of plants. But then for a lot of my outside plants, a lot of my full sun plants, they do draw in a lot of water. This will dry up way too fast, despite us watering every single day. So what we would do is we would take regular garden clay soil, mix it equal parts of that soil with this, we'll just mix it in, and that would really be wonderful for us. We could water them every day, not worry about overwatering, and it would retain water a lot longer. However, for a lot of our climbing epiphytes, our aroids, I have a secret weapon here. Horticultural charcoal, which we hammer down into a smaller size. We also have some pine bark. This is used for reptile growing, so we know it's sterile. If you buy the wrong pine bark, they can grow fungus and they can rot. So just be sure that you're using the right grade. Now what I would do is, I would mix a little bit of that in here because this dries up super fast. I mean, certain orchids, of course, and air plants probably can live in this and it would be very happy with this. But a lot of our monsteras, philodendrons, and theriums, what I would do is I would mix this almost equal parts into this, and then that would give me a nice balance of drying out. And also those epiphytic plants like your monsteras, they need to have these gripping roots. So if they believe they're gripping into a solid surface like this, it will invest in bigger leaves that fenestrate. They will grow faster. So this is why some of our aroids that we want for their spectacularly large leaves, I do supplement with a little bit of this media. I hope this makes sense for you, and I hope that you have success in your potting media because they really do elevate our experience and make our gardening experience better. Experiment with what you have in your area and experiment with your budget, your constraints, your environment, your watering style and everything. I don't believe that my potting mix will work well with every one of you. So just kind of draw a lessons here and there. I share with you exactly why I use certain things and use that why to sort of apply to your own potting mix. Do not just follow my recipe blindly because, like, as I mentioned earlier, I live in a tropical, huge, high humidity. There's a lot of airflow in this garden. We've got two fans on at all times. We water our plants every single day. And of course, most of my plants here are like aroids, begonias, and things like that. And every plant have different needs in different environments. So experiment. That's the whole fun part in all of this gardening. And with that being said, thank you so much for watching this all the way to the very end. And it would really help me out a lot if you would stay subscribed, like, and comment on this video. Send me an emoji. I usually write back with an emoji or something. This is because YouTube highly rewards engagement. And of course, in this crazy economy, if somehow you're doing well and you want to contribute financially to the channel, feel free to join my Patreon at patreon.com/seanfromonlyplants. And for like a cup of coffee a month. And of course, you can also join as a YouTube member. Simply open my videos from any YouTube browser, and next to my name, there'll be a join button. And I want to thank my Patreon and YouTube members for financially supporting the channel so far. You guys are really encouraging me to put better content out there, upgrading my equipment, and travel to more places, and share more of these contents with everybody. I wish you all well, happy gardening, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!